All right. Hello and welcome to day two of Variphy's Block Party. My name is Phil Corbin, Sales and Marketing Director here at Variphy. We covered a lot of cool stuff yesterday. Today, we're going to be getting into some customer success stories, business outcomes, and impact. We'll also be taking a deeper dive into the product. Vic, Matt, and Mike will be walking us through UCCX wallboards, hunt groups, all live. We'll also be rewarding one lucky winner, the ultimate work from home package worth over $3,000 at the end of today. So please stay online to see if you've won. Also, if you have any questions at any point during the event, please do not hesitate to ask them by clicking on the Q&A banner at the bottom right of your screen. We have our CDR ninjas standing by to answer any of your questions. Right now, we're going to go around the screen again. If you weren't here yesterday, we're going to go around the screen for introductions. So over to you, Danimal.
Thanks, Phil. And hello, everyone. My name is Dan Schmidt, systems engineer of 5 years here at Variphy. I want to personally thank everyone for joining us here at day two of our inaugural Variphy Block Party. We've got a lot in store for you again today. I want to give a huge shout out to our panel, as all of this would not be possible if it weren't for the people that you see on this screen. So included in our panel today is Lane Hu and Danny Tran, founders of Variphy. Annie Dang and Tom Nguyen, account managers. They're again live at the bar to raffle off some amazing prizes through today. For systems engineers on the panel today, please meet Mike Stratton, aka Magic Mike. Matt Sykes, aka Matty Ice. Again, CDR Jesus, Victor Verba. And last but not least, please meet the producer making this stream possible behind the scenes. A huge thanks to Dre DeVots. So now that we've met the panel, we'd like to take another moment and address the purpose of this inaugural virtual block party. Yesterday, if you were on, we mentioned how Variphy decided to create this virtual event to give us a reason to still engage with our customers, partners, and prospects since Cisco Live was canceled due to COVID-19. This very much still holds true, but now more than ever, with all the turmoil that has taken place in our country and world, I, as well as everyone else represented here today, are genuinely and authentically pleased to see everyone come together for at least one common good, one common goal. And so we sincerely thank you all for helping us achieve this virtual gathering amidst the turmoil our world is facing. So with that said, for day two, we have another packed agenda. So to lay it all out for us, I'll pass it back over to Phil. Phil?
Great. Thank you, Dan. Thank you all again for joining today. We have another action-packed day. We're going to get into some customer success interviews. We have Josh from University Hospitals of Cleveland, Amos from Viridian Credit Union, and also Joan from the University of Winnipeg. These are our customer success interviews, so please stay on to take a look. We're also going to get into some deep dives. We're going to get into some UCCX wallboards. We're also going to take a look at our native Qt hunt groups. So real interesting stuff there. And again, we're also going to give our grand prize of the ultimate work from home package worth over $3,000. We're going to give that away to one lucky winner at the end of day two. Right now, we have Edgar Salazar with Josh from University Hospital Cleveland. They're going to discuss how Variphy really helped and made an impact to their day and day-to-day workflow. So over to you, Edgar.
So we're here today with Josh Petro from University Hospitals of Cleveland. Under normal circumstances, this would be an in-person meeting at a bar somewhere in Las Vegas. Unfortunately, after the Cisco Live 2020 event was canceled due to the COVID-19 outbreak, we needed to find a creative way to remain engaged with our customers and the Cisco community while adhering to social distancing guidelines. So here we are at the very first annual Variphy 2020 Block Party. Welcome. Josh, thank you very much for joining us and sharing your story. I thought we'd start with a little bit about yourself. What is your role at the University Hospitals?
I am the Unified Communications Architect.
Around how long have you held that position?
It's been about 10 years that I've been at UH.
How large is your Cisco deployment, estimate about endpoints?
We have about 35 to 40,000 devices on our system.
Okay, is it a single cluster or multiple clusters?
That's just one cluster.
Okay. What prompted a need for a solution like Variphy? What problems did you need to solve?
Well, you know, with the cluster our size and with the business that we're running, it's just very difficult to know how many endpoints are being used, how many trunks are being used, you know, where we need to increase trunking, where we need to decrease trunking, where devices maybe don't need to be, or maybe we need more of. So just the general, you know, day-to-day business needs. Also, you know, call trees and you know, visibility into the systems that we normally wouldn't have visibility in. Just basic stuff of understanding how the system is or is not being used.
How did you hear about Variphy?
So I think we ran into Variphy with one of our partners, just trying to find out, you know, different systems that were out there that could do call detail reporting. I think we kicked the tires on a couple of them and found that Variphy was far and above the leader.
Did you participate in the product evaluation, a POC?
We did have a little bit of a product evaluation, and I think that's what kind of drove us to the purchase, that we tried it out first and found that, you know, it fit real well for us.
Can you explain a little bit just the deployment process from your experience?
Yeah, I think it's really easy. So we had the ability to run either an OVA file that ran Linux just right out of the box, or in our case, we wanted to run a version of Red Hat that our system supports. And so we were able to run that without any issues, and it, you know, worked out perfectly.
Have you personally upgraded your Variphy server? And if so, what do you think about the upgrade process?
Yeah, we did. And it was fairly straightforward. So there's nothing really to it. It's about as easy as it gets. And,
fantastic. How would you rate the Variphy solution?
Once you get up and running, and by, I mean, once you build a report or two and you become familiar with the system, it definitely is a 9 or 10 out of 10. It gives you exactly what you need. It's not like other products that can be real buggy or missing things right off the bat. The system has what you need, all the way from a system engineer level up to an executive level who's just simply trying to understand the bar graphs and pretty pictures. You know, again, down who needs to know the MOS score or packet loss on a single phone. It has it all.
What about the support? How would you rate the support that you've received from the Variphy team this far?
Yeah, so the support has been fantastic. Support gets back to us right away, which is really, really important. They generally have, within one or two emails back and forth, they have it figured out. They have run into basically every scenario. We've never stumped them yet, and it's just been phenomenal.
Thank you so far. Just a few more questions for you. Did you think the Variphy license and price model was fair?
I always feel like you could squeeze a little bit more out of any company, but that's just me. So I think overall, I think it's been fair. You know, if we've needed grace licenses, especially during COVID, you guys have been right there for us to help us out. You know, our cluster size increased rapidly in the past 60 days due to COVID, and you know, we went over our licenses right away. So you know, you guys were really good about helping us out with that, and I think overall, you know, it's been a purchase that has paid for itself already, and we've had maybe 6 maybe 9 months, and so it's been really, really good for us as far as that goes.
Thank you. And just one final question for you. What would you say to someone who asked about Variphy?
Someone who asked about Variphy?
Yeah.
Just, you know, explore it. Kick the tires for yourself and see how it runs. You'll be disappointed.
Fantastic. Josh, we really appreciate the time. You know, we understand your time is very valuable. We've taken up quite a bit already. Thank you so much for your time.
Thanks, Edgar. I appreciate it.
So we're here today with Josh Petrov from University.
Hi, guys. Welcome back to day two. My name's Annie again. I'm here with Tom in the comfort of our own home. I'm super excited because we're giving away some more fun prizes today. Remember to stick around because we're giving away one final grand prize for the Work From Home Like a Boss. But before I announce the first round of the first winners, we are going to be doing something fun. Tom, do you want to introduce that?
Hey guys, welcome back to day two of Variphy Block Party. Since we can't be in Vegas this year, we decided to bring Vegas to you. So we're going to play one game of blackjack, okay? If you win, you're going to win a GoPro 8 and a Sonos One music player. All right. Let's play one game. Let's go.
Okay.
Yep. So Annie, I'm gonna shuffle and I'm gonna have you cut with that.
Okay.
All right, let's do this. There we go.
Wait, so when is the prize again? So if they lose?
If they win, they get a GoPro and a Sonos One player. But if they lose, you have to give us a PO. That sounds pretty fair to me.
All right, let's play this game.
All right, let's do this.
I hope we win.
Ready? Here we go. Danny, cut the deck.
Let's do this.
All right. One hand. Let's go, guys. Oh, nine. Oh, 17. Four. Woo.
Uh-oh.
All right, do you guys want to hit or you guys want to stay?
I think they should stay.
We mean message. You want to hit or stay? It looks like they want to hit.
No!
No, I'm just kidding. Okay.
I say stay for the
customer.
All right,
you're going to stay. Okay, let's do this. Are you guys ready? Oh!
Do you want to go? Do you want to stay in or do you want to go?
I have to go. Let's do this.
Uh-oh.
One, two... No! PO by tomorrow, 4 p.m. 12 a.m.
All right. Thank you for joining that game, you guys. I will be announcing the winners for this round. We're giving away two Amazon gift cards and one Samsung Galaxy tablet. The two lucky winners for the two Amazon gift card.
Okay. Oh, the first gift card is the Amazon gift card.
Yeah, two Amazon gift cards.
Perfect.
All right, so Tom, do you want to announce the lucky winners for the two Amazon
gift cards? Yes, the first winner is Scott Brown.
Woo!
The second winner is John
Gallagher.
Woo! Okay.
And last but not least, for the Samsung Galaxy Ultra 5G. I'm sorry, that's not a tablet, it's a phone.
It's a phone,
I'm sorry, guys.
It's not an iPhone, though.
It's not an iPhone, but it's a Samsung. And the lucky winner is...
The winner is... Jeff Hintz.
Congrats, guys. Now we'll be handing it back for the UCCX Wallboard Ninja Deep Dive to Vic and Mike.
See you guys in a bit.
See you in a bit.
Thanks, Annie. Hi, everyone. Thanks for hanging out with us on day two of our block party. My name is Mike. I've been with Variphy for almost a year and a half, but I've worked with Cisco CDR for over 14 years. And and the guy below me, is also a systems engineer, and we saw him yesterday. He can almost deploy a Variphy system in 20 minutes. Victor, do you want to say hello?
Hey, everybody. Thanks, Mike. My name is Victor Verba. If you guys were able to attend yesterday, we almost got a Variphy system deployed in about 20 minutes. Thanks to my buddy Edgar over there for being a sport. So what do we got in store for us today, Mike?
All right, so for today's sessions, we asked our attendees to vote on what they wanted to see, and the UCCX widgets were one of the top requested topics. So we've touched on the UCCX widgets before in our weekly Wednesday webinars, but we can play around with the widgets more today. Side note, if you haven't attended one of our webinars before, we have them every Wednesday at 11 o'clock Pacific time. We keep them under 30 minutes long and usually cover more technical topics such as the CCX widgets, Hunt Group Reporting, Creel at the Grave, Cisco CDR, and any of the new features included in our new releases. You can sign up for them at verify.com/webinars. Today, Vic and I are going to design and deploy a dashboard from scratch. I'll throw some suggestions at him and he will build the widgets. A lot of new users kind of turn to us for tips on building a dashboard. They don't know what to do. They want something that's kind of nice to look at. But usually what they do is that they go in and they just select everything, kind of like when you put a kid in one of those frozen yogurt places and they just toss all the toppings on. So we kind of want to avoid that. So what we're going to do, I'll give Vic some ideas and he'll go ahead and then build a dashboard from scratch. Ready, Vic?
All right. Yeah, sounds good, buddy. So let's go ahead and do that. Let's go ahead and start a dashboard. We're going to call this our Block Party dashboard here. And we're going to keep this guy around UCCX, and I am going to turn on public access here, and we'll get to that in a second, but I just want to make sure we got that on. So here we are, Mike. We have got a blank slate. Tell me where we're going to start.
All right. First thing that we kind of want to see is something that maybe like a nice big focal point. It has to look pretty, maybe something real time with agents. So focal point, pretty, real time, and then agents.
Focal point, pretty, real time, and agents. All right, that's a good start here. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and do a real time agent widget. So that's going to be where I start. This is going to be real time widget. So this is live information. And the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to pick our real-time UCCX because that's where we're going to have some real-time information. So easy as that, I'm going to go ahead and click Next. That's going to bring us into our widget configuration page. We're going to give this guy a simple name. We're just going to call this RT Agent Widget. All right. So look at that. I already had one in there. But now that we've got that guy built, we can decide whether we want to show the title. We wanted to see, do we want to see some chart information? Do we want to see some legend information? I'm going to circle back to those guys in a second. So now that we're in here, Mike, this is a real-time agent. So what are some of the things that you're hearing, that you're building for some of our customers? And let's kind of bring that information into here.
Okay. Well, usually we want to see, you know, what they're doing right now. So what is their current status?
Good purpose for this widget. All right.
It is.
So let's go ahead and do current state with reason. Nice thing about this guy right here is we're not just going to throw a reason code. We're not just going to say, hey, you know, ready 1234 or not ready 1234 5. Other thing I'm going to go ahead and throw in here is the duration that they're in that state. Those are always kind of important things that people want to be able to see. And that's really from the real time perspective. You know, hey, what are my agents doing right now? If somebody's been on the phone for 20 minutes and they're talking, well, it gives me an opportunity to be able to see that. All right. Anything else we want to kind of shoehorn into this guy while we're in here? And keep in mind, we could always come back. And we're probably going to come back because I want to hit some of the charting information and the legend information as well.
Okay. What about their previous state? I see it in the screen right there.
You got it. Yeah, let's go ahead and add that. So previous reason, previous state with reason, and as well as previous duration. Do you want to talk a little bit about why those are important, Mike, or you want me to kind of just cover it a little bit?
I'll let you go for it.
All right. So think about this. Is I'm building a widget here that I'm going to be able to put onto a dashboard, or in this day and age that we're living in right now, this may be a dashboard that I'm sending a link to my agents. So that way they can kind of see where everybody's at. Now, I'm an agent. It's coming around noon, 1 o'clock. I'm getting ready to take my lunch. So I can actually just look up at my dashboard now. I can see, hey, you know what? I've got a bunch of people in lunch because I could see their current state and how long they've been at lunch. But not only that, if it's about 12:30, 1 o'clock, I probably have some people coming back from lunch. So being able to see the previous state and duration that they were in that state is a good indicator to me that maybe, hey, you know what? I can take my lunch now because I could see that 5, 6, 7, 8 people just got back from lunch. So it's good field to have in there. All right. So anything else we want to start off with, or let's just kind of roll with what we got?
I am good rolling with what we have right now.
All right. So next thing we're going to do is we're going to talk a little bit about search sets. So right now, my agent state is going to be for all of my agents in that particular UCCX. I can go ahead and filter that down. I can pick it. I can pick an individual team. I could say, hey, I just want to see the people in the Pickle Rick team. Or I can pick an individual resource group and then just show people in an individual resource group. Or I can actually combine the two and say, hey, you know what? I only want to see the people in this resource group and in this team. So I have the flexibility to be able to pick teams, resource groups, and individual agents. I think for this demo, we're just going to go ahead and show everybody, though. So I'm going to go ahead and save this guy. And there what we have is some nice statistical information of everybody who's in that particular UCCX. Their current states, their previous states, how long they were in those previous states. But what do you see here, Mike, that's just maybe not something I would probably want to see on my dashboard or my widget?
I definitely don't want to see all those people who are logged out because they're not logged in. If they're not logged in, I'm not worried about them.
That is an excellent point, and that's exactly what I was getting at. So we're going to go ahead and edit this guy down here and just going to click edit, and I'm going to go to my search sets. Now, for any of our agent widgets, this search set or this agent state is available in all of our agent widgets. So I'm picking on the real-time one here, but this could be for some more non-real-time widgets as well or some more statistical widgets. So in this case, I can build this widget around just people that are not ready. I could build it around people that are maybe just talking. So I have the flexibility to be able to build individual widgets for individual states. The nice thing about that is it allows you to really separate, individual, types of information or individual states of agents to really, draw pictures to certain states. In this case, I'm just going to go ahead and pick logged in because that's really all I want to see. That's going to go ahead and encompass my ready folks, my not ready folks, but again, also just include my not ready agents. And there we go. Now we've got a nice widget. It shows a few individuals on here, their states, their previous states. But you said you wanted pretty.
I want pretty.
I think this is pretty. We have some flexibility here, but let's go ahead and drill into this. So now I've got a widget. It's a little bit more statistical. It kind of shows who's ready, not ready. If I have a series of agents on here, I can also go ahead and adjust font size, based on the size of my monitors, but I can also adjust that vertical spacing. So if I've got an entire list of agents here, I'm able to size this a little bit different to be able to adjust for spacing and to accommodate more space on my dashboard. All right, but let's go ahead and dig into this guy a little bit further because there were a couple other options I wanted to hit. So let's talk about pretty. So on this same widget, I can go ahead and add some graphical information. I can go ahead and add some key information, or I can just kind of shift that a little bit. So what I'm going to do instead of just adding it all to this widget, I'm actually going to copy this widget. So he's going to pop up right below, and I'm just going to really change the format. We're going to make it easy to do that, and let's say for this one, I just want to see a legend. So I'm getting rid of my activity tables. I'm not going to be showing my durations and my states, and this is just a great way to be able to really simplify a dashboard and get some nice high-level general information. So now I've got a widget that shows basically just who's ready, who's not ready, reserved, talking, working, and things like that. Again, a little bit statistical, but also simplified, where maybe I don't need to see all of these durations. I can really just focus in on, hey, what's the current state of this particular team or resource group or agents? But we're not done there yet, buddy. So one more thing that we can do with this guy is I can also add some summary chart information. So maybe instead of stats, I just really want to see that gear. Whoop, let me go ahead and flip this guy here. So maybe instead of that, I really want to be able to see this gear here. And let's see here. And I want to be able to just see a little bit of a pie chart. I just want to know who's ready, who's not ready, how many people are ready. And this is going to give me kind of that gear to gauge, how many folks I have available or not available. So it's a great way to really just kind of block things out. And just make it a little bit easier for everybody to be able to see, depending on the type of room or who you're going to be sharing this information with. So you'll notice what I did there, Mike, is I just expanded on this a little bit here, and I'm going to delete this guy down here. And now we've got a little bit of a chart, and we've got some statistical information to show, hey, this is the state of my deployment or my UCCX, and these are exactly what all my agents are doing. And it's really that simple to go ahead and build a real-time agent widget. And as you saw, we can add other states in here. Another common one that I do like to add in here is actually what's called dialogues. What's dialogues, you ask, Mike?
What is dialogue, Victor?
Dialogues are basically just a little indicator of what this person's doing. So let's say, for example, my buddy Dan over here is on the phone with somebody. We're going to actually be able to show the phone number of who he's talking to. You know, if he received a call that was transferred and he's talking to another agent, we're going to actually be able to show that information. So I'll be able to see, hey, Dan's been on a call for 23 minutes with the same phone number. To me, as a manager, that's a potential problem because maybe my average call time is only a few minutes. So just being able to look up and see that somebody's been talking to the same phone number for 20 minutes is a great way for me to get ahead of a potential problem. I could walk over to Dan. I can ping Dan and just say, hey, you know, how's that call going? Is there anything I can help with? And just kind of rescue him if he needs a little bit of rescuing.
Perfect.
So
perfect.
How's that look so far?
I like it. I like it.
All right. So what do we want to kind of dive into next? I think this kind of gives us a little bit of the pretty as well as the statistical type information. And of course, you know, extremely editable. We can put as much in here as we want, or we can take out as much as we want. You know, again, just simplicity.
Yeah, I think it's good for what we have. I mean, it is pretty and it's very informative. What about, let's say I'm a manager and I want something maybe a little more higher level, maybe something at the queue level.
Okay, excellent. Yeah, let's go ahead and build that. This one was strictly focused on the agents. Now I'm going to go ahead and pop in and create a new widget. We're going to go to our UCCX here, and we've got a couple different options from the queue level. The same way we have a couple different options from the agent level. Now the real-time agent activity is a live feed. That's constantly updating. It's actually a live feed that we're talking to your call manager or your UCCX with. Some of this other one, like agent statistics, we're actually querying the database. So you get a little bit more flexibility, a little bit more columns, you know, when you're kind of looking at things like, you know, agent states, who's taking the longest lunches. That may not be something that I need, you know, necessarily real time. It's still a 30-second refresh rate, so it's still constantly going to be updating, but you're going to be able to get a little bit more historical information. So from the queue level, do we want to delve into something that's a little bit more real time? In other words, is this a dashboard that I want my agents to be able to kind of see what's going on?
Yeah, why not? You know, I always love real-time data.
All right, excellent. So let's go ahead and do that. So for that, I'm going to go ahead and build a real-time agent CSQ activity, and I'm going to go ahead and use our Variphy CCX for this guy. So from here, it's pretty straightforward. Whoop, I jumped right into the wrong widget there, bud. So let's go ahead and do this. And we're going to go into our CSQ activity and choose our Variphy CCX. And here we go. So now what I'm seeing is, let's call this ARTCSQ. But now what I'm seeing is, well, let's see, there we go. But now what I'm seeing, instead of a list of agents and fields, I'm seeing a list of queues. So the nice thing about that is now we're going to go ahead and build out something that's a little statistical, but it's going to be able to encompass multiple queues and show those values that we need to see in the real time from a multiple queue perspective. All right. So right here, you can see we've got a 5-second refresh rate. But what we're going to be able to do is then pick the stats that are most important to us. Obviously, we're going to show the queue name. So from a stats perspective, anything particular we want to look at here?
You know, I kind of want to see the total number of inbound calls and total number of abandoned calls.
All right. So easy enough. I'm going to just go ahead and I'm just typing in some key phrases here to be able to bring in some information. So we pick total calls, total abandoned calls, and those are good statistics for us to go ahead and start off with. I am going to go a little bit further here because there's a couple stats that I really like to have in these widgets. One, we've got the total number of abandoned calls, but I also like to see the average wait time of my calls in seconds. So that's going to go ahead and let us know, you know, how long on average are these people sitting in a queue for? But because this is a real-time CSQ, this is something on my dashboard, this is something I want to draw attention to, I also want to see the oldest call in the queue right now. So in other words, how long has that been sitting there? But I also want to be able to see the calls waiting. So how many calls do I currently have in the queue, and how long has that guy been sitting there? So these are some really good metrics to kind of start off with, I think. So let's go ahead and pop those guys on here. And now what we're looking at, let me bring this guy down here, scoot him over a little bit. So now what we're looking at is some queue information. So you can see we've got multiple queues, and this is a little bit where some being able to shrink down those widgets individually has its advantage. So if I go ahead and click on my appearance, I can go ahead and pop over to my widget, and then I can go ahead and condense that. So now what I'm seeing is basically a series of all of my cues, and this doesn't have to be all of my cues. I just picked them all just because, in all honesty, I didn't know which ones had calls and which ones didn't. But now what we're seeing is very easily, we're seeing what all my agents are doing. We're seeing which one of my agents are talking. I can pick which agents I want to be able to see, their teams, their queues, their resource groups. But I can also pick which queues I want to be able to see and the stats that I want to be able to see on those queues. Now, from a real-time agent perspective, this is a lot of what we like to see here. Because again, keep in mind that this dashboard is here to be able to help you, but also be able to help your agents. There's a lot more things that we can do statistically. So if I don't need to see things like real time, but I really want a widget that's going to be able to monitor service levels. In other words, how many service levels did we meet? How many service levels did we miss? Things like that, that can all absolutely be accomplished just by using a different widget type. So rather than focusing in on maybe real time, which is really what's happening right now, that's the purpose of that widget, I could focus in on something that's a little bit more detailed. And that's going to be a little bit more behind the scenes of, you know, more, you know, how's our queue doing this week? How are these queues handling this week? So we have the flexibility to be able to do both. So what do you think of this guy here?
I like it. But you know, the last widget has a little bit of color on it. Is there any way we can like add some color to that real-time CSQ widget, maybe with like a couple of thresholds?
There absolutely is. Let's go ahead and do that. Let's throw some thresholds on here. So one of the things we don't have in here are the number of agents available. So I think that's a really good statistic when we're looking at thresholds to be able to say, hey, how many people do I have? We have number of calls waiting, and that's an awesome threshold to have because if it hits over a certain threshold or level, we want to be able to change some colors and draw some attention to that. So I'm going to pop back into the widget, and the first thing I want to go ahead and add is I want to add available agents because I think that's a really good metric on a real-time widget. So the next thing I'm going to go ahead and do is pop over to our thresholds. So from here, we can create a threshold. Threshold is designed to draw attention to something problematic or something that's happening that's really good. So I can apply a threshold to every one of those queues, and it could be a single threshold, or I can pick out an individual queue and apply a threshold that way. So let me go ahead and pop back, and let's see if we can figure out a threshold. Let's say, well, I don't have any calls in queue, no calls waiting, so that's good. You know what? Let me go ahead and add that available agents in here because I do like that as a threshold. I'm also going to go ahead and throw logged in agents in there. Let's take a look and see what we've got. So now you can see dynamically updated, and we got a couple queues that we can go ahead and pick on here. So let's go ahead and I'm just going to grab a little screenshot, and then we're going to go ahead and build some thresholds off of the number of logged in agents and the number of available agents. So I'm just going to pop back into my widget over here. I'm going to click on thresholds and create threshold. Now, I don't need this particular threshold to apply to all widgets, or maybe I do. You know, maybe if I have no available agents, I want it to turn red because that's a potential problem. So for this one, I'm going to apply this to all CSQs, and I'm going to say available agents, and I'm just going to add an expression. And I'm going to say red when the condition equals zero. So now what I'm saying is anytime I have available agents for all of my queues, I want this guy to turn red. Now, the next thing I'm going to go ahead and do is create another threshold. So this one here, I don't want it to apply to all of my queues. I'm just going to go ahead and apply this to maybe one queue. And I'm going to say anytime I have, let's say, one of the metrics we looked at was logged in agents. This one's focused in on available agents. This one's going to focus in on logged in agents. Now, I know one of my queues here is not that busy. So I'm going to go ahead and say I want to be able to apply it to this queue. And I'm going to say whenever I have a logged in agent, and I'm going to add my expression, and I'm going to say I want it to turn red when it is, we'll say, let's go less than or equal to 7. So anytime I have less than or equal to 7 agents in this particular queue, I want it to turn red. So now I'm going to go ahead and save this guy, and let's see what we've got. First thing we did is we added a threshold to bring attention to problems that I have no available agents. Other thing we did is we said, hey, in this particular queue right here, I also want this guy to turn red when I have no logged in agents. So there's a lot of flexibility that you have with different values, different thresholds, the queues that I want to have in here, and the columns that I want to have in there. So how are we doing? Are we adding some color here, Mike?
I think it looks, I like it. It looks good. Add some color.
All right. Excellent. So you know what? Let's go ahead and do one more threshold just because I like different colors. So I'm going to add one more threshold in here, and we're going to apply this one to the all queues. So I'm just going to scroll down to the one that already has all queues, and we're going to go ahead and add, let's say, available agents, and we're going to add an additional expression onto here already, and we're going to say, I want this guy to be green when it is greater than, we'll say, 4. And let's just see what this guy looks like. And there we go. So now it's starting to look like Christmas. So here what we're doing is we're just adding some additional thresholds. It's very easy to do, you know, to individual queues or multiple queues, but I don't have to have all of this on here. I can create a completely separate widget with just a couple of these queues that indicate completely different values. So I have the flexibility in Variphy to be able to do that. All right. So what else do we want to do here? I know we've got a couple things going on already. Any other thoughts on things that we want to see in here?
I see some blank space off there off in the corner. How about those, you touched on those historical widgets.
I did, yeah. So let's go ahead and take a look at some of those. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to duplicate something that I build a lot with a lot of our customers, and that's to give that block year, more isolated call view. So what I'm going to do in this one is I'm going to delve into what's called a CSQ summary. And I'm going to, again, pick my Variphy UCCX over here. And we're going to build something out that is pretty common. So for this one, I'm just going to say, CSQ calls waiting. So for this particular one, what we're going to go ahead and do is we're going to make that blockier image. So I'm going to go ahead and pick, I'm just going to pick a series of queues. And I don't think I have any calls waiting. So, we're going to kind of see how this rolls. But I'm just going to go ahead and pick one individual value. And you'll notice my refresh rate on this one is 15 minutes. I can go down to 30 seconds on this guy. Again, this is not a real-time widget. It is a 30-second refresh rate because we are pulling this information from the database. So I'm just picking a series of queues. Now, the nice thing about this widget is if I have agents that, let's say I have 3 queues, it's the same agents that manage those queues. This is going to give you the ability to really just kind of sum up all those queues at once. So for this one, all they're going to do is pick a certain condition, and I'm going to say calls waiting, and that's it. And then, of course, I could set thresholds the same way that I did before, and I'm going to save this guy. So now the nice thing about this is now I'm getting that blockier image. So now I'm able to draw attention to, just the number of calls waiting and really just kind of put that out there. But the nice thing about this and the flexibility with Variphy, this is exactly what I need. It's got my queues, but I want to build something like this off of different values. So all I have to do is copy this guy. He's going to pop up right below here. And then all I got to do is just change my values. So maybe instead of calls waiting on this one, I want to do, let's say, an abandoned percent. So now I show for those same queues, number of calls waiting and abandoned percent. But I'm not done. So I'm getting some really good metrics. I can build these out. I can push these down. I can move things around. So you have the flexibility to add more. So I can see 0 calls waiting, but let's go ahead and expand on this just a little bit more here because there's a couple values that I really, really favorite for these types of widgets. All I'm doing, again, is I'm copying it. And right here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to type in abandon again. And I love this metric. This is a huge metric, and it's the abandon average queue time. So we're just going to create one widget based off of this information here. I'm going to shrink this guy down a little bit, and I'm going to move him up here. So now what I'm seeing is I've got the number of calls waiting, the percentage of abandoned calls. I've got the number of calls that and the average time they're going to wait in the queue before they abandon. But one more thing, and just because I really like to get this widget out there, and I always build this for customers because a lot of times they don't know we even have the capability of doing this, is I'm going to change this guy around a little bit, and I'm going to say instead of abandon average queue time, I'm going to change this to the average queue time. So now what I see is I get to see very clearly the amount of time someone's going to wait on average before they abandon and what my average abandoned queue time is. I always want this number to be higher than this number because if it's not, that means people on average are abandoning longer than they will actually wait in my queue. So it's a great way to be able to kind of get that information in there. So how did we do, Mike? Nice dashboard, pretty.
I think it's good. Yeah, I like it. We fill up the entire space. There's some widgets that are just showing some straight data, and other ones have nice color and plenty of information.
Excellent. So the other nice thing I want to hit before we close this out is the other nice thing about this, and I talked about in the very beginning, but I didn't tell you about because I was saving for the end, is this permalink right here. So this guy is going to allow you to, one, send this guy maybe to a dashboard or a wallboard. So now what you're doing is you're making this information available to all your agents, and this could be password protected if I wanted to password protect it. Now, normally what this was originally designed was around is that large dashboard where everybody was in a singular environment and they were able to put this up on a big screen. The way that we see this being most commonly used now is because of social distancing, because of the world that we're living in right now, is people are just sending this link to their agents. They're saying, hey, when you log in for the day, this is what you're going to have on your screen. So you know how our queues are. You know how our queues are performing. You know exactly what our agents are doing. So being able to share that via permalink, it's a static link. It's never going to change. The customers, they're saving it as their favorites, and this is what they get to see when they're logging in and when they're planning out their day, their lunches, their breaks, and things like that. So I think we did a pretty good job. We probably left. Do we have any Q&A or any questions that might have come through?
Nothing really. I think everything. We are running low on time, so I think we'll save all the Q&A for the QA at the end of the show.
Excellent. Excellent. Perfect. Well, hey, Mike, I appreciate your time, buddy.
Thank you for your time, sir. All right, and thank you, everyone, for hanging out with us today. I'm going to pass it off to Edgar with our second guest speaker, Amos from Viridian Credit Union. Take it away, Edgar.
Thank you. Hi, I'm back here at my home office in Frisco, Texas. This time I'm joined remotely by Amos Krause from Viridian Credit Union in Iowa. Amos, thank you very much for joining us and sharing your story. Let's start with a little bit about yourself. What is your role at VCU?
I'm a telephony architect here at Viridian, and I'm in charge of the phone system UC environment.
Around how long have you held that position?
I've actually been in this role for about 15 years.
How large is your Cisco deployment? How many endpoints would you say you're managing?
We have about 1,200.
What prompted a need for a solution like Variphy? What problems did you need to solve?
We had some difficulty just kind of with reports that were reliable. Just being confident in what we were provided, I guess, when we'd run reports. It seems like we'd run multiple reports and kind of get different answers to with the reports. So with the Edify, we've been able to simplify that process and have, confidence in those reports when we were home.
Were you relying on another third-party solution, or were you using just the native Cisco CAR for those previous reports?
We did have third-party vendor.
How did you hear about Variphy?
We did some broad searches and stuff like that. And then we took a peek at your website and watched some demos on it and were impressed with the interface and decided to take a deeper dive.
Fantastic. Did you participate in the product evaluation or POC?
Yes, I did. Yep. We kind of discovered it and then we took it from there.
Can you explain in your own words the deployment process?
Yes. So we went out and basically, we were able to put it right on our system and test it live and get results we were looking for right away.
I think you're one of the administrators of the Variphy system in your organization. Have you personally upgraded your Variphy server?
Yes, we've upgraded before. It's a very simple process. So basically, just browsing out to the location of the update and
In an overall, how would you rate the Variphy solution?
Top marks for sure. 10 out of 10 if on that scale. Like I said, it meets our needs and it's very quick when we're trying to pull something up. We use it on a daily basis. So.
Fantastic. What about the support? How would you rate the support provided by Variphy?
Also a 10 out of 10. They're support personable and they submit tickets.
Do you think the license and price model is fair?
Yeah, I think the price is fair. Supervisor had some questions for us when we first were looking at it, and we kind of convinced him that some reliable information is key, and it's made up for itself, definitely an ROI, basically within a short period of time, just the amount of time it took us to have confident reports in the past.
Fantastic. And then last question for you here. What would you say to someone who asked about us?
I would highly recommend Variphy to anyone. Like I said, their support is great and deployment, and they really listen to their customers. Right away, we got the feeling that, you know, it was kind of a different company to work with, because as soon as we gave feedback, short period of time, and they would actually be putting it into their product right away. So that was amazing.
We appreciate your time. We know your time is extremely valuable. So thank you so much for joining us today. Hi, I'm back here at my home office in Frisco, Texas. This time I'm joined remotely by Amos Krause from Viridian Credit Union in Iowa.
Welcome back, everybody. I have a special show to show you guys today. I'm going to show you guys how to get a six-pack, woo, a beer. During this quarantine period, I have to be creative and I have to work out somehow, right? I gained maybe 15 pounds during this quarantine period.
Same.
And I have to figure out, okay, how can I lose weight during this quarantine period? So I'm gonna show you guys how I work out. So I'm gonna show you guys how I work out, and Annie's gonna show you guys, or she's gonna
announce it. I will be joining you, and then I will be announcing the winners while we work out.
I'll be back, guys.
So Tom's gonna be doing some rep while I work out. Go ahead, Tom. Show them how to get some bicep curls.
One.
So we're gonna be giving away two more Amazon gift cards and the Apple iPad for this round. For the first two Amazon winners, the winners are Chris Allison, woo, and Philippe Bernard. Congratulations, you have won our Amazon gift card. What are you doing, Tom?
I'm working out.
Let me join you. And then our last winner for the Apple iPod Pro, the lucky winner is Tung V Lee. Congratulations, guys. Don't forget to stick around for the work from home like a boss. All right, I will be handing it back to Vic and Matt.
Thank you, Annie. Hello, all. Matt Sykes with Variphy here. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. This afternoon's deep dive session will be on native call queuing, specifically within hunt groups. Now, along with me is, as everyone knows, my buddy up there. That's Victor Verba. Vic, go ahead and say hi.
Hey, buddy. How's it going today?
Not bad. I wanted to commend you on your session yesterday with Edgar. That 20-minute challenge was fantastic. Been waiting to see him get dunked for some time now.
Yeah, you know, it was a tough session, man. I really, really tried to pull it out and not get him wet. But, you know, I mean, it is what it is. You know, a couple hiccups, a little bit of banter back and forth. And, yeah, he got a little wet.
A little bit. I'm sure you could have covered it, but fantastic job anyways. Well, everyone, once again, thank you for joining us this afternoon. This deep dive session will be focused on, you know, native call queuing within hunt groups. Now, we don't exactly have, I guess, cookie cutter canned reports for hunt group reporting within Variphy. That's because each environment is so different. It can be very simplistic, or it be complex, or a mixture in between. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this deep dive and jump into some deep dives into the CDR so that we can review exactly all the ins and outs, calls coming, you know, being passed to hunt groups from an IVR, from a Unity call handler, various other modes, variables of relay routing, if you will. Victor, what do you say? Should we go ahead and get the show on the road, sir?
Yeah, let's do it, buddy. So, you know, you hit on a very good point, Matt. And that, you know, the point being is a lot of customers will come and we'll start a proof of concept, and they'll, you know, the first thing they'll say is, you know, hey, I need some hunt group reporting. Do you have any canned reports?
Yep.
You know, here's the thing with hunt groups is there's no canned hunt group. Call manager doesn't come out of the box with hunt groups and routing. That's all things that are added individually based on your environment and how your environment handles. So as we're going to see throughout this demonstration, exactly why we can't come out of the box with, hey, here's a hunt group report, because it's not going to work. Every environment does things different. You know, calls could come into a hunt group and just get answered. After a certain ring time, they may roll to another hunt group, or they may go to a parking state, or mm-hmm. they may go to what's called a referral and then bounce back to the original person. So there's just a million different ways that hunt groups can route calls. So it's difficult to come out of the box with a hunt group report.
Sure.
So I think for today's demonstration, what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at a couple different scenarios. We're going to take a look at kind of what I'll call a bit of the standard hunt group report. And then we're going to spend the last few minutes trying not to bore everybody and take a much deeper dive into some real scenarios that we see. So, you know, after this session, one of the things that everybody should, kind of be thinking about is when they come to their SE or they're having some trouble building a hunt group report, depending on your environment, it may not be the first part of our session. It may not just be plug in a hunt group report and I'm going to get metrics. It may be something more towards the second part of our session where we're going to dig into, calls being parked, how long they've been, they're parked, how many calls are being abandoned in park and things like that. So, with that said, let's go ahead and take a look at some, relatively standard hunt group type information. So what I'm doing here is I'm running a report on a hunt group. I'm using the original called party number. The reason that I'm using the original called party number is because with Cisco data, Cisco has a tendency to duplicate the hunt group. So what I mean by that, in Cisco data, there's absolutely a field called Hunt Pilot DN, and we can absolutely report on those numbers. They're there. And what we'll see in this data below is that Hunt Pilot DN. But what we're also going to go ahead and see as we dig a little bit more into this is the reason that I don't like to use that. So first thing first is I ran a report on a hunt group, and I'm using this field here called Original Called Party Number. I prefer this field, and I've been in this business for a little while. Just through experience, I find that we're going to get much better values that the customers want to see utilizing this field than utilizing the Hunt Pilot DN. And actually, right off the bat is probably a perfect example, because what we can see here is a call that came into the Hunt Pilot ended at the Hunt Pilot. However, Cisco does not provide us a Hunt Pilot DN on this particular record. So if I were trying to run a report just based off Hunt Pilot DN, I'm not going to see this call. Reason being is it never really got answered. So if it doesn't get picked up at the Hunt Pilot, Cisco doesn't tell you that it went to the Hunt Pilot. So when you're using other solutions out there, or you're looking at Cisco CAR, if you're on the fence about your Hunt Pilot reporting or the accuracy of your numbers, what number are you using to report? Are you using the Hunt Pilot DN, or are you using the original called party number? Because if you're using the Hunt Pilot DN, you're probably going to either underreport or overreport your individual Hunt Pilot.
Yeah, definitely so, there, Victor. I've definitely seen plenty of unit calls, that roll over to unit that were presented to the Hunt that, like you just mentioned here, are missing the Hunt Pilot DN. So you definitely have to lean heavily on that original called party number.
Yeah,
if you
definitely
want to capture those not connected guys, yeah.
And that's actually, it's a pretty common scenario. So I'm going to go ahead and turn on Cradle to Grave and Verify and run this report. We're going to just take a look at these results, and we're going to go through them and just build, the most basic of hunt group reports. And in a lot of situations, this hunt group report that we're building here will work. It's when we get into the more complex situations like calls parked, calls rolled over, park referrals, people put on hold and things like that.
Reversions, all that good stuff. Yeah.
Exactly. And that's where things get a little bit more complex. And we actually start using this Cradle to Grave to dig out those metrics. So what I did is I'm still running a report on this 77280 Hunt Pilot here. It's going to tell me how many calls came into those Hunt Pilots, just some average durations and things that we chose to add onto this report. But you'll notice I added this column over here. This is related calls, and that's part of our cradle to grave situation or our cradle to grave scenario. So what Verify does is when I enable cradle to grave, we take our search, which is any call to this Hunt Pilot, and using this field, and we can see all those calls that came here. But what we do is we actually formulate what happened before and after the call got to that point. So this is a very, very important situation or a very, very important piece of information. Because not only are we going to show, hey, here's the call that went to this endpoint, we're going to show how the call got to that endpoint and how the call maybe went after that endpoint. So if, let's say, Matt, you take a call and you transfer that call out to me and I transfer that call out to my buddy Edgar, we're going to show all of that by enabling this cradle to grave, and we'll show that entire sequence of events. So just by toggling that again, let's say, hypothetically, this person called and I need to speak with a manager. I had a terrible experience. So I can run a report on their phone number, turn on Cradle to Grave, and I'm going to get to see every single person they talk to, every hop they took along the way, if the call got parked, if it hit a park reversion, if it, you know, got answered by somebody, then reparked. We'll get to see all that when we turn on Cradle to Grave just by toggling that option on. All right. So just kind of looking at this one, pretty basic call. Call comes in this case, it goes to a Unity system. They hit an option in there, rolls out to my call center. I can tell they rolled out to my call center because it's hitting one of my CCX devices. From there, I could see that that call gets answered by Kathy, and she speaks for 43 seconds. Let me see if I can blow this guy up a little bit for us here.
Hey, Victor, where were those two bottom call records or kind of like encased in orange?
It's a good question. So when we're reporting with Cradle to Grave turned on, remember what I said in the beginning is that we are searching for just this number. So instead of just giving you a Cradle to Grave situation or scenario and saying, here, your calls are in here somewhere, we actually highlight those in orange to draw your attention to what you actually searched. So that's why those guys are brought bold, just to kind of bring attention to what's going on.
Matching the search set, in other words.
Exactly.
Gotcha.
Exactly. Spot on. Matching the search set. So then they rolled into, you know, Debbie spoke with this person. So the call got transferred into the hunt group, rolled into the hunt group. I could see it rang out to the hunt group for about 8 seconds. And then it got answered over here by Lindsay. Lindsay had a nice 1 minute and 52 conversation with this end user and then ended the call. And I know she ended the call because I'm looking at my termination codes here of normal call clearing. Normal call clearing at the terminator of the call means that the final call party ended that call. So I get to see the whole picture of what this customer went through and who they got to speak with each time. So just kind of scrolling through here, you see a couple different situations. And Mac, this is a perfect example of what you had just talked about. Mm-hmm. So here's a call that came in. They went to our main number, rolled into our voicemail system. From there, they hit some options to roll down to a particular department. In that case, it rolled into my hunt group, which is exactly what it's supposed to do. But the call did not get answered. And in this particular situation, it rolled into Unity. So depending on, again, hunt group configurations, that's actually a thing. Some customers just say, hey, if nobody answers the hunt group, roll it right into Unity. Or if, let's say, nobody's available to answer the hunt group, roll the call right into Unity. And that's exactly what happened here. But notice if I were reporting on HuntPilot DN, I don't get it. So I would never see that this call took place if I was trying to report that HuntPilot DN.
So that's true.
A good reason to say, hey, if I'm looking to see all the calls coming into my HuntPilot DN, well, I would have missed this one. And it's important to know how many customers are rolling into the Unity system from the Hunt Pilot. So here's another good example. You know, here's a call that comes in. Actually, this is a really good example to talk about how Hunt Pilot can over-report information. So here's a call comes in, rolls into the voice messaging system. They hit an option, roll out to our Hunt group. I see that this call over here gets answered by Nikki, and she speaks for about 48 seconds. Excellent. That's what we want to be able to see. From there, Nikki makes a determination that, hey, maybe you've reached the wrong group, you reached the wrong department. They hit the hunt group, and they're popping into our maintenance department. So Nikki transfers that call over to the call center. All right, so I could see it, again, going into my UCCX because I could see a UCCX device here. I also see UCCX ports and triggers. So a lot of different ways to be able to identify UCCX calls.
Okay, so Victor, sorry, mm-hmm. Don't mean to cut you off. So we're actually kind of witnessing right now. We're actually seeing kind of a call traverse through UCM and then into contact center and back out, correct?
You got it. Yeah, you're spot on. That's exactly what we're seeing. So we've got a lot of different ways to identify that. But with Variphy, besides just being able to look at this and diagnose the call flows, we can actually pick things out of here. So we could pick out certain scenarios. So I can run a report on that hunt group and say, well, how many times did that call go to a UCCX agent? Or out of this hunt group, how many times did calls get transferred over to maybe home services? So other than just looking pretty and allowing you to see the flow, we can actually pick calling scenarios out of all of these values.
You mean we can have it our way?
We can have it our way, buddy.
All right.
So in this case, again, rolls into the UCCX, gets answered over here by Charles. I could see Charles has a wonderful 2 minute and 20 second conversation before then transferring that call over to owner services where Katie takes the call and speaks for another 2 minutes and 53 seconds. Now, there's a couple things that I want to draw attention to on this call. Besides being able to see this call flow, again, if I were reporting off the Hunt Pilot DN, I reported this call 1, 2, 3, 4 times. Why? Because Cisco presents the Hunt Pilot DN every time that call gets transferred. And if Katie over here continued to transfer that to somebody else, we'll continue to show that Hunt Pilot DN because Cisco does. So my point in saying all that is sometimes the Hunt Pilot DN that you may be using in your current system or just looking at in CDR is not going to go ahead and give you the accurate results you're looking for, where here we're going to go ahead and count this call once, And then we're not going to go ahead and show this four times just because it got transferred four different times. Now, let's say Nikki over here got tired of talking to this customer and she just transferred them back to the hunt group. Well, then we're going to see that call twice because she's actually sending it back to the hunt group. And in our next session here, what we're going to do is dig a little bit more. And we're going to actually be able to show some of those values of how many times people, you know, maybe got transferred back to the hunt group or got parked and then rolled back to a hunt group or a hunt group entity.
That would be more accurate too, wouldn't it? Because that would be another call presented, if you will, to the hunt group.
You're exactly right. So when you're looking to try to see, you know, how many calls, how busy is my hunt group? It's not the one-to-one scenario that a lot of people want to see. You know, how many calls came into the hunt group? That's easy. Just report on the hunt group. But how many calls, how busy is my hunt group depends on how many times people are getting transferred in and out of that hunt group, being transferred back into that hunt group. Because, yeah, maybe 10 calls came in, but if five of those calls ended up getting transferred back to the hunt group for one reason or another, well then, you know, maybe that's 15 calls that are actually being handled at that hunt group environment or that particular department. All right. So, you know, that's just the idea of a general hunt group. And from here, we can build a lot of different things. So right now I'm in the reporting section. So, you know, in the general environment, let's say, you know what, hey, I've got my hunt group. I want to see some general metrics. Very easy to add. Here's your total call count, average call count, abandonment, you know, abandoned call count. If I want to see hourly statistics, I could come down and just say, hey, I need to see my busy hours, add the hour a day, add a total call count, and then maybe during my busy hours, I want to see some average call duration, ring duration. Of course, I want to see the abandonment percentages. And in my case, I know calls can roll in the Unity, so I want to see my Unity counts as well. And we'll go ahead and break that down hourly for you.
Yeah, definitely want some voicemail in there.
Mm-hmm. Especially in this type of environment, but that doesn't meet everybody's environment. A lot of times,
exactly.
Hunt groups don't flow back to the voicemail system. They may go to a secondary hunt group, and if they don't get answered there, a third hunt group. So again, that's why from a canned report perspective, there's just a lot of different things hunt groups can do. So the next thing we're going to do is just really quickly, we're going to add some data grouping. Data grouping is basically a secondary layer of summary. So the first thing I'm doing is I'm summarizing off all those calls that came into that hunt group. But I also want to see who's taking those calls. It's important for me to know, you know, how many calls are coming in, and then, of course, who's handling the load. A couple different ways we can do that. One, I can just come over here and summarize off of the terminating end user, and that'll show me, you know, the end users that are answering calls. But what I also want to see is maybe my hunt groups can be answered by multiple departments. In other words, that hunt group is more like a shared line appearance, or it could ring on, you know, several different departments. So I can actually group this by and show summary on how many calls went to those departments, but then also in those departments, who's handling those calls. And then I can say, hey, what do I want to see from those that particular perspective? So very quickly, we just created a nice general summary report that's going to really give the general business manager what they want to see to be able to manage that hunt group. And this is kind of in, you know, a bit of the rudimentary environment. So what we're going to go ahead and get into in a second after this report runs is a little bit more in depth. And we're going to get into a little bit more of the complex environments. But to just give you an example of what we quickly built here, I can see this is my search. I'm still looking at the hunt group here. I'm still showing the calls, the fields that I asked for. But now I chose to break that down by department as well as end user. So you can see my maintenance department is the only one answering this hunt group. So we don't see anything else over here. I could see all the calls that came in were handled by that department, and then which individuals handled those particular calls.
Hang on.
All right.
Where did you get these departments and user IDs from? Were they in the data?
It's a good question. That's a good question. So they are not in the data. So first names, last names, departments, even like things like device pools or types of phones, none of that information is in the data. But the nice thing about Variphy is it's also not in Variphy. So Variphy is basically a no maintenance solution. You install the guy in 20 minutes or less. You install the guy in 20 minutes, and you really never have to come back to it to maintain first names, last names, departments, extensions, device pools, and things like that. Variphy works a little bit different than other solutions out there because we don't have this big background repository that you have to constantly update and maintain. Nobody wants to do that. It's a rudimentary form of having to maintain yet another directory, because then now you've got Active Directory. Now you've got Cisco Call Manager. Why have to maintain another system by keeping track of your end users? So what we do is we actually read your call manager live. So we've got a single-threaded Axel query, so we don't beat up your call manager. We go out, we pull this information as the report is being generated. So as we started pulling back this detail, we went back out to call manager and we said, in this particular example, who has this MAC address? We take that MAC address, we go back to call manager, we could say, oh, you know what, Kimberly's got this MAC address and this is her department. So we actually pull that information live from your call manager and you never have to maintain it and verify.
Ah, once again, we're having it our way, huh?
Once again, you are having it your way, buddy.
Good deal, good deal.
So yeah, so that's a basic, you know, hunt group report to really be able to give you the statistics. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to shift a little bit, Matt. So that was kind of, you know, simplistic hunt group. All we did is just run a report based off of original call party, chose the stats that we want to be able to add, the fields that we want to add. But like I said in the very beginning, and like you said as well, there is no one, what is it? What did you say? It's no cookie cutter solution.
Yeah, there's no one cookie cutter canned report for hunt groups.
There's no one cookie cutter canned report, and this is the reason why. So now with the remaining time, what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and delve a little bit more into hunt groups. And we're going to take it above your kind of standard cradle to grave that we were just looking at, and we're going to dig into some metrics. So right now what I'm doing is I'm popping over to another system that I've got some more complex data in. You'll notice this system, anybody was on our call yesterday, this is Edgar's system. So we just took that live system here and we just threw some data at it. I didn't have to put a directory in here because Variphy does not require a directory. So it was very easy for me to just go ahead and throw data into it without having to worry about first names and last names and things like that, because all that's housed in the call manager. So what I'm doing with this guy is I'm going to run a little bit more of a complex report here. So I'm running it on the same hunt group because I've got some complex data for this hunt group, but I didn't want to mix it in with more of the simplistic data. So all I'm going to do is view this information, and I've just got a couple calls in here, and you're going to see why. Because if I added any more calls in here, we would need another couple hours for the session.
You got your wetsuit on, though, don't you?
I do. That's more Edgar's cup of tea.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
But let's go ahead and take a look. So I ran a report, basic hunt group, still looking at the same thing, original called party number. I've got some calling party numbers, but you're going to notice in this example here, I've got a lot more fields in here. I'm looking at things like last redirect DNs. I've got some departments in here, things like that. I've got some other fields that are great with a system like Variphy because Cisco does not present this information the same way that we do. And what I mean by that is I'm looking at things like determination on behalf of, join on behalf of, call pattern usage types. When you're looking at Cisco data, Cisco's going to give you a number. They're just going to say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And if you're trying to build this type of information out of Cisco data, you're basically going to pound your head against a brick wall because every single one of these fields, you would have to go back and look up what this value represents.
Well, that sounds fun.
It's about pounding your head against a brick wall. I've done it plenty of times. But with Variphy, we're going to go ahead and give you the translated value. So we're not just going to show you a number. We're going to actually show you what that value means.
The English translation, if you will.
Exactly. The English translation of Cisco data. You got it.
I can dig it.
So with this, I'm going to go ahead and run this report. So the first thing I'm going to do is just export this guy. Again, I'm going to turn on my cradle to grave. You'll notice we've got a lot more columns in here than we did in our last report. And we're going to need those columns to really dissect what's happening in this call. So I toggle on my cradle to grave. I'm going to change my format to HTML. Now, you may be asking why I constantly keep going to HTML. Reason being is when you're dealing with detail or when you're dealing with something with a lot of columns, PDF is great, but it has a tendency to start wrapping things. So I really need to see things in a row so I can start determining what makes one call different from another call. So I can absolutely use Excel or CSV or PDF. HTML is just personal preference because I think it just appears cleaner on the actual screen. So this guy's running in the background. It's doing the same thing that my other system did. It's going out, it's grabbing all my calls to that particular hunt group, and it's going to formulate those calling sequences together for me. So you're going to see right off the bat, I've got 77280. I've only got two calls in here. And I'm not super concerned with the average duration, total duration as of yet, but we can continue to compound onto those search results relatively simply. Next thing I got is my details section, where it's just going to show me the two calls that match my search criteria, 77280. And I did turn on cradle to grave. So here we have our cradle to grave section. What I get to see in my cradle to grave is much like what we saw in the other system. Call comes in, hits a Unity system, bounces over to the Hunt group, and in this case, it gets answered. I want to have this call in here because I need this data, and I need the fields in this data, because what I'm going to do in this next report is I'm going to actually build some metrics behind this down here. This is a call that I want. This is from a customer service perspective. I want to be able to see calls that came in and got resolved right off the bat. Did not have to bounce around, did not have to get put on hold. So we'll call this like first contact resolution type information. So, and that's what I'm looking at with this record. But I need these other fields here to be able to prove that. So, and we're going to show you why down here.
Yeah, you got a lot of you got a lot of columns there. I'm hoping you're going to clean this up for us pretty soon.
I do got a lot of columns, and we could absolutely clean this up. Okay. So, you know, one of the things that we're doing here is we're building this report. When we finalize this report, I don't need to have any of this in here. When we finalize this report, basically, I'm going to have some summary values that you get to detail what you want to call, and some numbers behind those. So you don't have to have any of this detail, any of these fields. If I just wanted some basic fields, I could add those. So we could definitely clean that up for you. All right, so now let's dig into this guy. This guy's fun, he's easy. This is exactly how a call should go. This guy down here is not the best customer service situation. Matt, did you know that that there's some customer service companies out there, and I don't know if you've ever had this happen to you, this has happened to me though, that you'll call in and you may get put on hold, you may get parked, and it doesn't have to be a call center environment. It absolutely is a Hunt group type of situation. But after you're on park for a certain amount of time or you're on hold for a certain amount of time, they just hang up on you?
Oh yeah. It happened to me last week, my local internet service provider. They did not get a good rating after that, let's say.
No, that's funny because I've got a certain internet provider that I have the same problem with, that if I'm on hold for a certain amount of time, it just disconnects me.
Oh, yeah, it's brutal.
Again, but that goes to the complexities behind Hunt groups because there's a lot of different things you can do. So let's take a look at this call. I see a call come in to, again, my main number rolls into the Hunt group. In this case, you'll notice this one's not orange because I actually omitted zero duration calls in my report intentionally because I didn't want to double count this guy in my total calls, and that's up here. However, I am still going to count this guy in my subtotals because I think this is a very relevant value. So here's a call that comes in, rings into the Hunt group, but doesn't get answered. And again, you're looking at all of these codes and going, oh, Jesus, this is a lot of information. It is. But the nice thing about it is once we build these reports, you don't have to ever look at this stuff again. You build the reports out. We make our determinations on how we differ one thing from another. We build the metrics, and then you're kind of out of it. You can utilize this report if hopefully your other Hunt groups are configured this way. A lot of times they are, to be able to roll this down to the next report and next report.
And potentially standardize it for the environment that it's in.
Exactly. You're gotcha. Spot on. Exactly. So the next thing we're going to go ahead and look at. So now I can see that this call didn't get answered. This poor guy rang out for 120 seconds before my Hunt group kicked in and said, "Up, after 120 seconds of ringing, I'm going to go ahead and kick it back to the Hunt group." So here we go. We went back to the Hunt group where luckily Edgar saved the day and he was able to answer this call. And he spoke with them for about 11 seconds, probably apologized for letting it ring so long and said, "Let me get you over to the proper department." So this is where complexities start to come in. This is an important value because I want to know how often this happens. Edgar answered that phone call, and then he went and put this person back on hold to be able to get him over to the right department. So he may have picked up his receiver and said, you know, "One second, let me send you over to our parts department." So now Edgar's sending him over to the parts department. In this particular case, he was probably sending him over to the Duncan department, but we'll see what we can do. Now, more really pertinent information. So this call gets parked. I know it got parked for a couple different reasons. One, I know this is my parking route point. So I know anytime I see this in my data, it's a call that got parked. Two, I'm going to use some of these other fields here to determine this call got parked. So right here, I could see called party pattern usage, and I could see direct call parked. Nice thing about that is that gives me a key. That gives me a focal point that I can then report on to say how many calls got parked. Very easy. Now, the next thing we're going to go ahead and look at here is something that's a little bit different. So this guy sat on park for 4 minutes. So for 4 minutes, this guy sat on hold listening to music. Poor guy. It's a terrible experience.
I hope it was Dre's mix.
Unless it was Dre's mix, then it was probably a pretty decent experience, and that's why he probably sat on hold for 4 minutes.
There we go.
So this poor guy sat on hold for 4 minutes. Then, after 4 minutes, the way that this system is set up, is after 4 minutes, it goes to what's called a call park reversion. Not every system has this configured. After a certain amount of time, it's going to punt it back to the DN that answered that call. So we can see on our next call some very pertinent information. One, this call goes back to Edgar. So after 4 minutes, the call went back to Edgar. But we also have this guy over here that says call park reversion. So that lets us know that this call actually reached its timer and then got punted back to Edgar, where Edgar, after 4 minutes of sitting on hold, a minute and 20 seconds of ringing, Edgar probably basically just got chewed out for a minute. So after that 1 minute Edgar just profusely apologizing, he said, you know what, I still can't help you because I am not part of that department. I'm going to need to put you back on hold. So now this guy's probably fuming because he's been around the system for a long time. So the next thing he does is he goes back on hold. And Matt, how do I know he's back on hold?
Because of the cause code.
Well, the cause code.
I'm sorry.
I knew where you were going. So now I could see he's back on hold because of the direct park. I could see that he is my call party pattern usage type is direct park. And I also see that he's using 7877, which is my direct call park. So there's a lot of different ways that we could determine that this poor guy went on back on park. Now, Matt, tell me how your experience would be if I called into a company, rang for 120 seconds, got put on hold for 4 minutes, talked to somebody for a minute, and then got put on hold for another 4 minutes.
Going to go on a limb and say I'm probably not going to be a happy camper.
You're absolutely right. I would not be a happy camper, and this is not a very good customer experience. Now, the good thing is what we're getting at here is all of this information we can pull into a report. So we're going to be able to say how many calls got direct answered, how many calls went into park, how many calls got answered off of park, how many calls got abandoned on park, how many times did somebody hit my call park revision. So all of these good experiences and these bad experiences, we're going to go ahead and create into a report using this cradle to grave. But last but not least, after 4 minutes of sitting in park, the call finally went reversion, went back to 111. Now you'll notice 111 gets answered by a different person, so I actually get to answer it. So what Edgar probably did is he saw that caller ID and he said, no, I'm not answering that call. I'm letting Victor take that one. So then I got stuck with this customer who now rang for 120 seconds, sat on hold for 4 minutes, sat on hold for 4 minutes again, and basically chewed me out for 3 minutes. And then we hung up the call. So I could tell the call ends here because of this field right here. Remember in that other report I had said that terminating code, when I see normal call clearing, that means that's the terminator of the call. So a lot of information, but some very good key information. One, we can tell when calls don't get answered. Two, we can tell when calls get parked. Two, three, we can also tell when calls come out of park because they never got answered. And four, we can tell when a call ends. So a lot of really quality information that we're going to go ahead and build into this report. So we're going to take this same calling scenario or these two calling scenarios right here. And I know this is a lot of information for people to absorb. I mean, minds are probably spinning going, oh, God, I hope I don't have this type of environment. And a lot of people don't, but some people do. And these are the things that a Variphy Ninja works with you guys to help build. And a lot of times, a lot of our customers look at us and be like, I don't want anything to do with this type of metric. Do it for us. And for those types of situations, we absolutely get involved, and we do offer a service called the Ninja Enhanced Consultative Services, where we will actually look through this data with you. We will build these reports. We will build these metrics with you. So that way you don't have to go through this level of information. But as you're going to see in a second, a lot of it's not that hard. It looks hard. But when you're comparing the records row by row to develop your calling metrics, it's a lot easier than it actually appears on the screen.
Yeah, so, well, it doesn't exactly look like your grandfather's hunt group reporting now, does it?
You are spot on. It is not your grandfather's hunt group reporting. And the reason we can do this is because we are not built on some of those old legacy platforms. We are built out of a UC platform that recognizes that all of this information is different yet pertinent information. So you're right. It is not your grandfather's call accounting system or call analytics system. So now, less talking, less more going through the records. Let's build this report out. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to come back right over to my call history screen. From here, I can actually start building this report. So I'm going to go ahead and click export results the same way I was doing before. So we're going to call this party report. All right. And we're going to go ahead and keep that. Woohoo! So the next thing I'm going to do, and hold on one second, I am getting a little thirsty here.
Yeah, a little parched myself there.
A little parched. But the next thing we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and look into the metrics. So our first metric here is built off of how many calls are coming into that hunt group. Easy enough, we've already got that. But all of this other stuff is not part of that call record, because remember, when we highlight in orange, we are highlighting the pertinent value that matches our search. If I searched on the hunt group right here, it's not going to show up because that hunt group is not in this call record. So next thing we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and dig into cradle to grave. So now when we were looking at that previous session, I said, hey, you know, all those fields are also searchable and reportable. So, you know, how many times did something come from my UCCX, or how many times did a call go through the UCCX? And we were looking at that very pretty, easy to read cradle to grave types of situation. We can also drill into those metrics.
So, come on.
I'm not kidding. So let's go ahead. We're going to do that right now. So we're going to go ahead and dig into those metrics. The first thing we've got is we got how many calls are coming into those hunt groups. We've already established that through our search set. But the next thing I want to know, and this is very important from a business unit perspective, is how many calls are coming in and being answered and have that first contact resolution. And that's what we're going to focus on first, because that's always a very solid metric. You want that to be a high metric. So I'm just going to name this guy one, and I'm going to call it first contact resolution. All right, so we're going to go ahead and give this guy a name. Now, in order to determine this, there's a couple different things we're going to do, and this is probably the most complex of all of the scenarios that we're going to have to go through, because what we're trying to do with this one is make sure that it's different from this one. This is a call that came in and talked to somebody, and the call ended. This is a call that came in through the hunt group and also talked to somebody, but this call didn't end. So we need to make sure that we are differentiating this call from this call, because this one got resolved. This is your first call resolution. This is what we want to see. Where this one did not, and this poor guy ended up sitting on hold for another eight minutes before chewing me out for 3 minutes. So what we're going to do is we're going to build some search sets to be able to differentiate this guy from this guy or any other call that came into the hunt group and may have got answered or transferred around. Now, to do that, we're going to focus in on what's different. Right off of the bat, what's one of the things that I said? How do we know a call terminates, Matt?
Cause codes.
Good job. You are paying attention. So there we got our cause code. So I can see the originating cause code and the terminating cause code in this data. So what you'll see here is normal call clearing. That means our call ends. All right. This one is not going to be normal call clearing because the call didn't end. It's going on to do something else. So that's going to be one of our first focal points here. So in my cradle to grave, I'm going to say cause code, and I'm just going to type in originating or terminating cause code, and I'm going to say normal call clearing, because that is indicating to me the end of a call. So I also know that I want to focus in on the calls just coming from the hunt group. So other calls that may have not terminated from the hunt group or went on somewhere else are also going to be in here, because maybe they started at that hunt group. But for this metric, I only want to know the calls that came to the hunt group and had that first call resolution. So I'm just going to punch my hunt group number right into this guy. All right, so I'm going to make sure I turn on this guy, because I always forget what this guy's going to do. And even Matt and I were kind of going through this yesterday, and I popped up my report. I'm all happy to go. We're getting ready to get off the phone. I'm like, my values don't match. I forgot to turn this guy on, and I always do. What this is going to do is it's a difference between an and or statement. So if I turn this guy off, it's going to say, hey, I want to see every single call that has this as the original called party number. And it's also going to say, and I want to see every single call that terminates normally. That's every call in your organization. It's not built off of the two of these sequentially or being combined. But by checking this, I'm saying, hey, whatever call I bring back has to meet this and this value. All right. But we're not done yet. There's a lot of different things that could happen here. A call could come into this number, ring out, and the call can terminate. In other words, it's an abandoned call to the hunt group. But I don't want that, because that's not a resolved call. So how do I eliminate that? I eliminate that by saying the call went to an extension. So now I'm saying that the call started at the hunt group, my original called party number. It went, had a normal call clearing in one of these two fields. And I'm going to say it terminated either by maybe a hard phone device, extension, a series of extensions, or something like that. In my case, I know my extensions are 4 digits, so I'm just going to add a final called party filter with 4 X's. So let's go ahead and add that. And we're going to go ahead and pop this guy in there. And yeah, I'm hoping everybody's hanging out, because this is data. This is what we live for and live with, being able to develop these numbers. And these are very solid numbers of what we're going to go ahead and build. Yeah, so now what I've got some information that says, hey, these are all calls that came into the hunt group that ended. normally. In other words, they ended at an extension because I know my extensions are 4 digits. But there's one more thing we want to do to be in here just to be safe. So you'll notice I had a couple other fields in here. So I have the original called party redirect reason, or redirect on behalf of. You'll notice that's CCTI, which means it's coming from a route point of some sort. And I've also got last redirect on behalf of. You'll notice this one is also a CCTI line because the last redirect was basically just a CTI route point. This is important because if I ran a report that, let's say, a call comes into a person, doesn't get answered, just rings out and hangs up, it's already going to meet my criteria here because it rang into extension, it came in from a hunt group, and it was a normal call clearing, but I need to filter those out. Or let's say Edgar took this call and handled it, but it's also not first line resolution because this person came into somebody else first. So we need to get a little bit more granular by filtering out some of those transfer type scenarios. So what I'm gonna actually focus in on is that last redirect on behalf of. You'll notice when the call comes in and gets answered off of that last redirect on behalf of is the CTI route point. But when it got forwarded because it didn't get answered, that last redirect on behalf of is call forward. So like I said, this is probably the most complex of the scenarios because we're trying to weed out other transfer calls and really just hit the ones that got that first line of resolution. So I'm going to actually throw a filter in there that says last redirect on behalf of equals call forward, and that's going to allow us to filter out this one or any other calls that may have come from various sources and transfers and focus just on the ones that came from the hunt group. So let's go ahead and add that guy in here. And you had asked, you said there's a lot of fields on there. There's a lot of fields on there.
That's, I was just going to mention that. I said, oh, that's where you extrapolated that information from. Okay.
Exactly. So I'm just going to go to CCTI line. And all I'm really doing to develop this information is I'm looking at differences between these rows. So how can I differentiate this call from this call? And I know I had the normal call clearing, but you know, if I had a lot more records in here, you're going to see records that have normal call clearing that meet this that may just be abandoned calls or got transferred in from other route sources. So we want to be able to make sure that we're encompassing all of this information. So let's go ahead and add that. Now we've built a very, very simple criteria to 4 different search sets that are going to show our first call resolution. All right. This is great, but we need a little bit more because not every call is coming in at first call resolution. So I also need to build another search set. So for this guy, we want to see all the calls that got answered off the park because we know that a call could come in and get parked. And then go somewhere else. And that's a very real criteria, and that's a very common situation. So we're going to say calls resolved from park. And we're just looking at this particular metric is strictly for the calls that got resolved at park. Now, how are we going to determine, Matt, how a call ended from park?
We'd be looking at the C2G record, but we'd be looking at the codes again, I would think.
You are spot on. So here's a call that went through all of the motions that went through park and answered and hit the hunt group and everything like that. And I need to be able to track this. But here we can see it got parked. Now, I want to be able to focus in on calls that came from park. So me, I know that this guy right here, as I stated earlier, that's my call park. So I know that that pattern right there means a call went onto park. So I can actually focus in on that to say, hey, these are all the calls that came into park. But using, again, those codes, I can say these are all the calls that ended from park as well. So we're going to go ahead and add some metrics in there. So now that we've got first call, our calls answered for park, we're going to say that last redirect, DN, because if we're looking at our data, this indicates to me that that call came from park. So if we look at Edgar's call, I can also see that same number there, it ends from park. But I don't want to count Edgar's call in here because it didn't end there. Edgar ended up putting that guy back in park where it ended here because I answered it. So now we've got our... So
that clause code is actually giving you a lot of leverage there, isn't it?
That clause code is giving us a ton of leverage to be able to utilize those. So it's a very important field when we're trying to determine how calls end. So now I'm going to go ahead and say that last redirect DN, but remember, same thing we always fall back to, and that's that cause code. I'm going to say that originating or terminating cause code equals normal call clearing, if I could spell normal. So there we go. So now we're building some metrics. So now we're saying anything with that last redirect DN is 7877, and it's a normal call clearing. So I can see that guy here. And easy enough, easy peasy, we've got those metrics. But we're going to add a little bit more, just because, again, I know data, we don't have a huge data set here, but there are some other things and other ways that calls can come in to get parked. You know, calls can reroute and be parked. Calls can go to the hunt group and get parked. So, and let's say a call gets parked. and it ends there. Well, that may be a call that is terminated in park, which is, again, another very valuable metric. So we're just going to go ahead and filter this down a little bit. And I'm going to say also that the final called party number equals my four digits. This means this is how I know this call did not terminate in park, because it actually made it out to an extension. So there I've got my park. It's not going back to a hunt group. But you may be asking, Matt, well, 7877 is also a four-digit extension.
That it is.
And so is 111. So how is that going to differentiate if a call got terminated in park? We're also going to add in this same filter.
Exclusion.
Does not equal. Exactly. Does not equal 7877. So now what we've done is we've identified calls to extensions, with the exception of this one that ended normally, where it got redirected from park. So we've developed some very meaningful values here.
Make sure you match all those, sir.
Yep. Good call, man. Good call.
Gotcha.
All right. So next thing we're going to do is, you know what, let's run this guy. So I'm going to go back to basic. We're going to save this guy, and we're going to just call it party report here, and we're going to save this guy. So hopefully we haven't lost anybody yet, because this is real life. These are scenarios that people go through when they have complex situations. You know, everybody hopes that they have the first section of this report where they could say, hey, it's easy, just plug in the hunt group number and I'm going to get all the metrics I need. Not always the case. Some of these calls bounce around, but these are all very real metrics. So here what we have very clearly on the screen: the number of calls that came into the hunt pilot, number of calls that got resolved in first contact resolution was just one, and the number of calls that got resolved from park was just one. So the nice thing what we have here is we're seeing the total number of calls coming in, and we're also seeing how they got resolved. So we are seeing that the good news is they are getting resolved. But what we're going to go ahead and add in here is all of the experiences that take to get those calls resolved. You know, calls that sat on park, how many times they got parked. So this is good to be able to see, hey, just a high level of how many calls are coming in, how many calls are, you know, getting parked or, you know, being answered from park and first call resolution. Right here, we've actually got a really good report to be able to really see what's going on and at least make sure that those calls are getting answered. Because let's say this number were 24, but I can see only two of them got answered. Well, I know I have a problem, and a lot of people are probably abandoning calls. But those are the things we want to see. So now that we've got this report created, let's go ahead and edit this guy, and we're going to add even more. But the point of what we're doing here is showing that these call metrics, other than just looking very pretty, they also have a real purpose to be able to dig out these metrics. So now what I want to see is I'm getting to see how many calls are resolved, but we're going to go ahead and show some additional information. We're going to show how many of those calls actually went into park. So I'm going to call this guy number three, calls sent to park.
Or parking lot attendant, maybe?
Or parking lot attendant, exactly. So naming conventions completely up to you. You can put whatever you need in here. So now we're going to build another metric. And like I said, things get a little bit easier after we've developed our first couple metrics of, one, identifying calls answered on first call resolution, and two, just identifying the calls that went to park. So now we're just going to look at some metrics to determine, you know, how well is my environment actually performing? Because if I look at just those two metrics, it's not that bad. Two calls came in, two calls got answered. Hey, we're batting 1,000.
There you are, 1-to-1.
Exactly. But when we look at these other metrics, we could see, well, we're not quite batting 1,000. So number of calls set to park. So in order to do this, we're going to go ahead and focus in on that original calling party number. But we're not going to focus in on that hunt group, because if you look at our data, anytime a call goes to park, we could say, hey, it came and went to these particular numbers. So that's one way of doing it. However, there is an easier way of doing it. Rather than having to focus on individual numbers, you'll notice this guy that I was drawing some attention to over here before, this call party pattern usage type.
That an easy button?
What's that?
Is that an easy button?
That is an easy button. You got it right.
I love those buttons.
Easy button. So here what we're going to do is we're going to use this guy to indicate any call went to park. So I'm just going to say filter. I want to tell anytime a call went to park, we're going to say direct call park or call park. So rather than focusing on original call party number, I'm going to focus on usage, call party pattern usage type. I'm going to add this guy, and I'm just going to type in the word park and direct call park. In my case, I'm also going to add park in here because I know there are other ways that calls could come into park. So that's it. Now I've just identified a very easy metric of how many calls went into park. Do we want to stop there?
I think you left out a bunch of stuff, buddy.
I did.
Nice try, though.
Only not only do I want to see all the calls that went into Park, I want to know how many times somebody called in and rang out and nobody answered. And again, it's happening. So what I can do is focus in on that terminating cause code. Anytime I see a terminating cause code of no answer from user, user alerted, I know somebody rang in and just didn't get answered. Again, a very valuable metric. Now, this isn't a call that didn't eventually get handled. You know, this person eventually got handled way down here after sitting on hold for about 8 minutes. But I also want to know how many times this is happening. How many times is somebody calling my organization and just ringing and nobody's happening? Nobody's answering those calls. So very easily, we're just going to go ahead and add another metric to this report.
Sounds like calls RNA. Too much of that round robin going on.
Too much of that round robin going on. And very easily, again, we're going to focus in on those cause codes. But for this one, I only need to focus in on one cause code. And that is the terminating cause code, because it is the person that the call is going to, the recipient of the call that is not answering. So that's going to be the terminating cause code. So very easily, I could say terminating cause code, no answer, user alerted. So now, again, very easily, I just created another metric that's important for me to know, because now I get to see how many times is this happening to my customers. And another very valuable metric, and then we'll kind of close this out because I know we're going to be running low on time. And there's a lot of different things we can do. You know, we can continue to compound down to these, depending on what your organization wants to be able to see. You know, how many calls are abandoned in Park? How many calls are abandoned during a ring no answer? Those are all things that we would be able to pull out of this data by utilizing that cradle to grave. But last but not least, we're going to say, number of callers that sat on hold too long, and we're going to go ahead and say bad. So we're going to go ahead and add that guy in here. And again, we're going to look at our data. Very easy to look at. One of the things I pointed out earlier was this call park revision. Anytime we see that, I know that this person sat on hold way too long, so long that it actually bumped the call back to the original person that had it. So all we got to do is focus in on that last redirect reason, and off we go.
You make it sound so simple, Vic.
I do make it sound simple. And you know what? Look, I've been doing this for a long time. But it's once you're staring at the data and you're looking at the data and you have those fields available to look at, it's just a matter of picking out those different call flows and calling scenarios to say, oh, this is an important metric for me and my organization. So let me go ahead and add that in there. Yep. So now we've got these metrics. I'm going to scroll down to the bottom. We've got our summary information. I want to know the total number of times that happened, average call duration. We could add some abandonment values, but we're actually building those values into the report because of the cradle to grave complexities. So I'm going to save this guy. We're going to give it a run. And I'm going to kick over my HTML format. I'm going to choose a previous month because that's where I've got this data. And let's give this guy a quick run and let's see what we get. So what I hope to get is the number of calls that came in, the number of calls that got handled, which is what we've shown on the other report. But what I also want to see on this report are very meaningful metrics. So this is great. I could see two calls came in, two calls got answered. But out of those two calls, twice those calls got parked. Once, somebody hit a ring no answer and didn't answer the call. And twice, somebody hit that call park. In other words, they sat on call on hold so long that they actually bounced back. So being able to see these things, you know, being able to know how many calls got handled is great, but what is that customer's journey? And in this case, if I just had these two numbers, customer's journey doesn't look so bad. Two calls came in, two calls got answered. But when I see how long it took for those calls to get answered, how many times they had to sit on a park reversion or even get put on hold at all, I can see that those two metrics of just being answered and not answered are not the most important things in the world. Because looking at that, I'm batting 1,000. But when I look at the metrics to how they got to get answered, that's when I can see that, hey, maybe we have a real problem here because a lot of these calls are going into hold. A lot of these calls are sitting for 4 minutes before they're actually being answered. And some of them are even hitting ring no answers where nobody's answering the hunt group. That doesn't mean that everybody in the hunt group is busy. That means that some people are not busy. Those phone calls are actually ringing and somebody made an effort to not pick up that call and it went and did something else. So again, that's why those are very important metrics. And of course, like you had asked before, can any of this be cleaned up? It absolutely can.
Oh, yeah.
All of this search criteria, we don't want to see this. Maybe even the cradle to grave, we don't want to see that. So it's very easy to go in and just turn off simple things like that.
Clean it up,
buddy. I can go into search set statistics and do that. I can go into my cradle to grave. I can go ahead and toggle that guy off. And you know what? And if I don't even want to see the cradle to grave, but I still want that summary information, very easy to go ahead and do that. So, you know, I appreciate everybody for hanging in there. And just to kind of give you a little glimpse of, you know, how this data looks and what some of our ninjas go through to develop some of these reports, but also what you guys can do to develop some of these reports and how we look through the data, just to give you a sample of ways that you can look through your information. So I know, you know, we are running right up against the clock. Matt, do we have any questions out there?
You know, honestly, Victor, a few that did filter through, you actually cover them during the content about the consultative services. Obviously,
okay.
We can go ahead and build all these C2G reports up for any environment that we need to. We're more familiar with the data. We're used to, you know, rolling up our sleeves and getting, you know, elbows deep into the data on a daily basis. So it doesn't scare us at all. So we kind of welcome it, actually. So by all means, definitely reach out to Variphy Support if there's any needs for that. As well as, let's see here. So we talked about that. We cleaned up the report. We talked about traversing through CCX. Oh, I suppose, yeah. And exactly. On this report here, I was going to mention with regards to you. So you have a top summarized section, and then you have a secondary C2G summary section.
Right.
Now, it's true that this should not be one-to-one matching, because like you had just mentioned, I believe that even though there's only two calls that were communicated with that hunt group, that actually had multiple appearances, if you will, and multiple handlings that we want to identify for proper productivity in the environment.
Yep, you are spot on, Matt, and that's exactly what's taking place, is we're looking at things outside of just the total call count here. This guy wants to see the total call count, but this guy's looking outside of just the total call count to determine what my customers are actually experiencing when they call in.
Very well, very well. Let's see here. A lot of concert requests here, I'm seeing, but I think that should wrap us up. If there's any other questions that we have, we can definitely address those at the very end for our happy hour Q&A. So thank you everyone for joining us. Victor, solid job as always up there with your Scuba Steve gear on. So thank you much for all your assistance. And we're going to pass it back over to Annie and Tom for more prizes. Thank you all.
Guys, welcome back to round three. We're going to be giving away some more prizes, and don't forget, we're also going to give away the grand finale prize after this round. But one more thing, Tom has something special to show you guys.
Hey guys, welcome back. Are you guys having a good time? If you are, say woo, woo. Okay guys, so I'm going to show you guys a magic trick, okay? I can't tell you. I'm gonna show you guys. You know, special requests, a lot of requests been going through my emails asking me for a magic trick. So I'm gonna show you guys how to disappear and be somewhere else.
Wow!
Right?
Wait, I'm so curious.
Okay, should we get started?
So I'm gonna show the magic trick first, and then I will announce the trick right after.
Okay. Okay. Let's do this. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Are you ready? Are you ready? Okay, count down. Like that. Sorry,
that.
I can't do that.
All right, let's go.
It's a magic. Let's do this.
Go ahead and announce the winners. We're going to be giving away two more Amazon cards and a Microsoft Surface Pro. The first two lucky winners for Amazon gift cards is Mickey Von E.
Woo! Woo! Hey, I know you. Count it, count it.
To Variphy's virtual block party. My name is Chris Durkach and I work for CompuGen, one of Variphy's resellers up in Canada. Today I'm joined by Joan Dusserdick, one of my customers here in Winnipeg. Joan, great to have you.
Hi Chris, great to be here. Thanks for having me.
Joan, tell us a little bit more about yourself. How long have you been at the university and what's your job role?
So I've been at the university for 24 years. I started out in my current department, Technology Solutions Center, as admin assistant, and I was working for the director of the department. Almost 10 years ago, we switched from our Nortel system to our Cisco VoIP platform, and I was given the opportunity to learn and become the telecom analyst for it. Essentially, it became my baby. My job is to keep the dial tones at the university running smoothly, like a well-oiled machine, and actually, I even have more to do now with COVID happening and everybody's working from home.
So, John, what's the size of the university? How many buildings? How many devices do you have in Unified Communications Manager?
So we have approximately 10,000 full-time and part-time students. We have about 800 faculty and staff, give or take a little bit. The university main campus has 11 buildings, and then within a two-block radius, we also have another 8 buildings. We have approximately 1,600 devices registered, and that number continues to grow every year.
It's great to hear that you guys are continuing to grow, especially amid COVID-19. So with the devices, the faculty and students, and you mentioned you have about 1,600, how many servers do you have in your collaboration environment?
Well, our environment is pretty straightforward. So we have 3 Unified Communication Manager servers. We have 2 Unity Connection servers, 2 Unified Presence servers, 2 Emergency Response servers, along with Expressway Core and Edge.
So that's great. Those are all the Cisco servers, but what about your Variphy server? Can you share with us how Variphy has helped you on a daily basis to do your job?
So a few things that I've come to rely on are some of the reports. In normal times, as in pre-COVID-19, we use Variphy to monitor the usage on our PRIs. I also run reports on IVRs so that management can monitor the number of calls received in peak periods. And we also keep track of long distance usage. The DID, DN management is also a huge asset that I use quite a bit right now.
All right, so you mentioned DID and DID management. That's a fairly new feature. Can you let us know how that has helped you in your job, as you mentioned?
Sure, I use DN management often. We have about 1,800 to 2,000 DIDs, and Variphy helps me sort through them and identify which ones are actually in use and which ones are not. It saved me hundreds of dollars because now I don't have to go and purchase new DIDs from our telco. It really helps decipher our monthly telco bills also.
Great to hear that it helps you decipher those crazy monthly bills, because I know they can be confusing. What are some of the challenges that you look to solve when the university was looking into a CDR solution?
So our monthly bills started to seem a bit more than we thought they should be. So we thought there has to be something out there, some sort of software program that could assist us in helping out with these billing issues. After a discussion with CompuGen and a presentation about what Variphy can do for us, and the ease of using it, it was a no-brainer. We signed it. Variphy and CompuGen have been there for us too. When I've had a question or I needed to upgrade, when CompuGen hasn't been able to help, Verify's tech support staff are amazing. Every time I had an issue about something, they're quick to respond and to be very helpful.
Well, great to hear that Variphy was the right choice for the university and you're really realizing cost savings. So I got one more question on my list here, and it's kind of a silly question. Generally, at this time, around Cisco Live, which is when we're recording this, Variphy runs a campaign called CDRKitten.com. So my question to you, Joan, is, do you really think that Variphy has a kitten named CDR and that the kitten really knows anything about call detail records?
Well, I have 2 cats and a dog, and I'm pretty sure that neither one of them know anything about call detail reporting. But I do know that when I'm working from home and I have Variphy on my laptop, those cats have to walk all over my keyboard and they sit and stare at the screen. So who knows? Maybe the mascot of a kitten is what they should be, and that's why they're watching the screen. I think it'd be fun too, even to, when you log on to Variphy, maybe you should put a little drop down that has a cat meowing. I think that'd be kind of cool. I have a couple cats that'd be volunteering their services.
Joan, that's a great suggestion. Variphy, hey, need any more suggestions or you need the sound of a cat meowing, reach out to me. I'll hook you up. So, Joan, thanks for joining us today. It's been really great talking to you. Appreciate your time.
Thanks, Chris. It's been fun chatting with you, too. And thank you, Variphy, for inviting me to be part of this.
Well, that wraps us up from Winnipeg. Stay safe, have fun, enjoy the rest of the block party. Take care. Thanks, everybody.
Wow, Joan and Chris, you guys are hilarious. Thank you for the kind words, the humor, and taking the party outside for a little while. You know, if I didn't know better, I'd think we pivoted and started making t-shirts with cats on them as a business. Geniuses. So anyways, you know, special thanks also to Amos Krause of Viridian Credit Union and Josh Petro from University Hospitals for sharing their stories. Much appreciated from our team here. Apologies, you know, Tom and Annie lost a little bit of audio there, so we'll be reaching out to the winners that they had just recently announced, and Dre will also be recapping those winners along with the grand prize winner shortly. So to all of you, you know, thank you for attending and making this such a great event for us, for our customers from the bottom of our hearts. We are grateful for your business and for your trust. You know, I know many of you are, you know, too busy to take the time to reflect. And that's definitely the case with the team here. You know, there's always just too much to do, and we always default on and focus on just, you know, the essential tasks at hand. You know, reflection is certainly a good thing. It's not something I do well. So I'm really grateful that the block party has allowed us time to do just that. But most importantly, to be able to spend some time with you all, to wish you well, and to give away a lot of cool stuff. You know, big thanks to Phil, Dre, Dan, Annie, Tom, Edgar, Vic, Matt, Mike, you know, and the entire team. You know, as Dan had mentioned, you know, these are crazy times for all of us. And, you know, many of you are on the forefront of seeing, responding, implementing the technology that enables collaboration and keeps our countries running. I think we have 6 countries other than United States here in attendance, and it's pretty late in their time zone. So, you know, thank you for joining us and staying up with us. You know, to kind of wrap up my part of this, you know, we're, you know, at Variphy, we're doing our absolute best to be a thoughtful company. And, you know, we're doing what we can to help our communities, our neighbors, our employees, our at-risk customers, you know, both at the corporate level and as individuals as well. And as Lane mentioned yesterday, you know, if we're not all in it, you know, for our employees, they're not going to be all in it for you. And so that's just something that he and I, you know, will strive to do. And we love working with them and staying in the trenches with them. Small plug here for the webinars that Mike had mentioned. You know, if you don't have that on your schedule for Wednesdays, I definitely recommend that you do add that and keep advancing, you know, your Variphy skill set. Those webinars are short, sweet, chock full of information. And we've also recorded, you know, the past webinars, so you can certainly peruse those at your own time. What else? Again, you know, if your kids also, you know, if your kids' summer camp is canceled, I can't imagine a better time than to have them spend an hour with CDR Jesus just to help fill the void. Last 2 minutes here, I don't know how many comments we got for, you know, staring at Ronald McDonald's butt while they're looking at you, Vic. So great job there choosing the Ronald McDonald there. But for our partners, you know, thank you for your continued trust and support. You know, great to see so many of you on today. You know, we aim to be the easiest partner to do business with. And most importantly, you know how well we're going to treat your customers and the value that our software brings. So, you know, sign them up for a free trial and we'll handle the rest. I think as Vic showed you yesterday in the 20-minute challenge, it's about as painless as can be. And even if they're not currently in the market to purchase, you know, the data gleaned from the trial is well worth its time. So, you know, that's it for me. I'm going to kick it over to Lane with some, you know, final parting words.
Yep. Lane? Yep. Yeah, thanks, Danny. Yeah, you know, it's not just a product of the COVID, right? It's the people, the humans that I'm actually really thankful that all of you joining in today and of course yesterday have had a chance to kind of virtually meet and see and hear. And, you know, I know many of you have worked with many of them over the years via WebExes and whatnot, but it's always nice to put a face to a name and to kind of see the human element for who you've been working with on the other end. And it's a group of people that we're very proud to put forward and represent us and be in front of us on most days than not. So I want to thank our team for putting this all together. A ton of work went into this, somewhat last minute when we decided to, of course, not have an event in Vegas physically for Cisco Live, and to take this from a normal WebEx to a live stream event, as a lot to went in. So as Danny mentioned, big thank yous to our Block Party team, who's going to go about their business tomorrow doing what they need to be doing. Thank you to all of you for the steady stream of feedback, questions, thank yous, comments about this event, and of course, product enhancements and suggestions. It's something that we take very seriously here. We love to hear it. So keep bringing those to us. They will not fall on deaf ears. They will get thought about, reacted to, prioritized, asked further about. We always want to understand what exactly we can do to make things better. In particular, as we get into some of the things I spoke about yesterday with Cube, Jabber, and other Cisco products, I would love, as our team would, to hear, really fine details about what would be really helpful to you guys. And of course, that can help drive what we actually look to accomplish. Something funny that I actually found myself realizing when Vic and Matt and Mike earlier on the two deep dives were that some of these are real deep. And I get that for many of you, it may be too deep. Not that you don't want to get into that level, but you maybe don't have the time given all that you have to do on a day-to-day basis. And that's really what our ninjas are for. I kind of realized they had the self-reality that I don't know this stuff quite as well as our team does. And I'm really proud to say that because we always try to find people that are smarter and better than us. So that's what we're here for. Please feel free to reach out for assistance in any way for our ninjas to help you. They are, as Matt said, they welcome the stuff, they love it, they live for it. So they're more than happy to dig in. And in many cases, it just takes poking around inside your environment to see some test data, to see some calls go through, to really make sense of it all. And that's something that they really enjoy doing. I'll wrap this up by saying, I wish we were all in Vegas physically shaking hands, as strange as that experience kind of feels. I'm really looking forward to getting back to some sense of normalcy. Hopefully that's later this year, certainly next year. And with that, I will, hand it back to Dre for our grand prize giveaway. Thanks, everybody.
Hey, everybody. Hope you can hear me out there. Working through some technical issues here with Annie and Tom. But thank you guys for sticking around. We're going to recap real quick the winners from the last round. So we'll start out with the two Amazon $50 Amazon gift cards. We got Mickey Koyanevs and Stephen Loveday. They won the two $50 Amazon gift cards. And then also, we were giving away a Microsoft Surface Pro 7. And Justin Hodson won that one. So sorry about that, guys. By the way, I am Dre, system engineer here. Thank you, everybody, for sticking around these last 2 days. It's been a great 2 days. So much love and support from everybody. It's been great. We do have a fantastic grand prize to give away. As you can see on the screen here, we've got a really beautiful ultra-wide monitor, high-end headset, an adjustable desk, MacBook Pro, a new chair, a Mixology set so you can get some drinks in, keyboard and mouse, a green screen, desktop speakers, a webcam, and a docking station, all so you can work from home and have some really nice stuff. So, without further ado, let's go ahead and pick this winner. A little drum roll. The winner is Janet Suzik. Congratulations on the grand prize for our stay-at-home grand prize winner. So thank you guys so much. Doing everything here, producing this show as well. So it's been a little rough to keep up with everything. So thank you guys. We are going to answer some questions next. The whole team is on. We do have some questions queued up for you guys. So stick around, ask some more questions, have a drink with us, and thank you again. Go. Sorry.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Dre, and the rest of the panel for helping us out on these wonderful 2 days. So there have been a lot of questions coming in, and stay on time here. We've got a long list of questions that we could answer here for you. So Let's get right to it. We've got our panel online to help us with some of these questions here. First question coming in from Luke. This is a follow-up from yesterday, actually. Made a good point, and we wanted to make sure we get this cleared up, is Luke wondered if we're pushing everyone to cloud, our Variphy hosted solution, come end of year. Rest assured, we are not pushing everyone to cloud. We will absolutely still have an on-prem solution for our customers. So it's just your choice of flavor, on-prem or cloud hosted. So I just want to clarify that for Luke. Had multiple questions. So Bobby and Jeremy asked, can a report or widget be created that will show which caller input was selected through a Unity call handler? So yes, we are very aware that, you know, there's built-in reports from Unity that gives you statistics based off of button presses. I think Victor and Matt kind of got into this a little bit, but utilizing the cradle to grave search sets, we could very well easily hone in on those button pushes. Typically what we see is after a user hits a menu option within a call handler, that call will be transferred to a specific extension. As long as we see that in our cradle to grave contents, as they showed, right, you could kind of hone in and splice out specific statistics and get summarized statistics just upon that. So Victor, Matt, I'm not sure if you want to add any more content to that question, but we did see multiple instances of those questions come through.
Yeah, I think I chatted.
Sorry, go ahead, Matt.
Thank you. Dan, I think I chatted to someone about that yesterday. I mean, you were on the right path there. I mean, definitely once they, you know, they're in a Unity handler or a call tree and they press an option, the next leg should be in the sequence is the extension that's actually going to ring to that that option or that service group. So we should definitely see that and be able to identify that in the raw CDR. And that way extrapolate that information in the C2G report to see how many times of the inbound traffic, how many times the user pressed, you know, 0 through X. Yes, you were spot on there.
And you know, to piggyback off that, Matt, just to kind of say, July 8th, I believe it is, we are doing a webinar on how to go ahead and develop that information.
You're right, we are.
So, you know, feel free to join us for that webinar. We're going to kind of get into some of the details on kind of how we can best determine those Unity options that are being pressed.
Yeah, excellent. And thanks for reminding everyone on that webinar series. We're constantly adding to it a lot of great content to view. So thanks for that. We got another really good question from Brad. And this is regarding the wallboarding session that we did. So Brad missed entering the question before the session was done and over with, but still wanted to get the question addressed. But Brad wants to know if there's a way to pull SLA stats to the dashboard. So the typical, you know, detail and live stats that we see today, does that involve SLA information as well?
So, Dan, to kind of talk about that, we can definitely do that. We can pull SLA information. A lot of that SLA information is really set within the contact center. So things like, you know, SLAs for time, you know, abandoned calls missed, ring times, queue times, and things like that. We can absolutely pull those into wallboards, dashboards, as well as reporting. Those are in some of the more detailed UCCX that I was kind of referring to, but we can definitely pull some of that information in. So, you know, we'd be more than happy to jump on the line with you and work through some of those dashboards with you.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Victor. More so of a comment, but from Richard here, he's really digging your Variphy hat, Victor. So, and as Danny mentioned, a few comments on the clown's butt in your background. So, nice selection as always.
I saw the comments, so I had to go with the tiger for the closeout here.
Great selection as always. So getting a little bit more serious here, Jay has submitted quite a few questions here. I want to get some of these outlined as well. Going in line with the cradle of the grave, you know, really in-depth conversation about the cradle of the grave. Basic question, but you wanted to know what version does this come in? Just to you know, safely announce that the cradle of the grave feature comes standard with your CDR call analytics. This has been around as far as, you know, as I can remember. I've been here for 5 years. So if you have the call analytics feature, you will get that cradle to grave component and really get a lot of useful information as Victor and Matt showed us earlier today. So just wanted to lay that out there. Here's a really good question. Jeremy asks, I guess while running some searches while we were going through these sessions, they do use hunt groups in a native call fashion. So Jeremy asks, when I do a search for my hunt pilot by the original call party number, as we have instructed, I get a lot of terminating device names that is parking lot device, but all the same global call IDs. How do I clean this up a little bit? And I think we really hit at this during the presentation. So for Jeremy, if you enable that Create of the Grave component, you're going to see the complete sequence of the call. What you're specifically seeing is that call in queue. When a call enters into queue, it's essentially going into parking lot until a line group member has the ability to take that call, at which point that parking lot device is actually transferring that call to that line group member's device. So you're basically seeing multiple call legs stacked up into a sequence. You could very easily throw in another filter if you do not want to see this content, right? If you don't want to count this content, as Victor and Matt kind of explained to us, you could very easily throw in that additional search criteria option that says, you know, we could do it a multitude of ways, but final call party number does not start with C00. That's a default parking lot number that's used. You could also filter based off of that device name or device description. Make sure, as Victor pointed out, to enable that match all checkbox. That's your and statement. But if you wanted to filter that out, you could very well do so that way. Victor, Matt, anything else you wanted to add on that?
No, you take a shot at that. Go ahead.
Yeah, I think you're pretty spot on. And that just kind of it bodes to what we were talking about is there's, you know, I was going through a certain sequence of events that we have that were live and real events. Each, you know, different scenario can do different things. Like you've got a device that's parking lot device. You may be able to use some of the usage type information to filter those in, filter those out. But it does depend on the routing. So it is a lot of just adding those additional columns in there to see what can I utilize in this data set to get those types of metrics that are most important to me. You know, in your particular report, maybe that parking lot, that's the one that you want to omit. Like Dan had said, maybe you could just filter out those C00 records and you're not going to see those parking lot devices. But maybe you on another report, it's important to know how many times those calls get parked. And that's where it comes down to that first call resolution. In other words, the call that came in and got answered immediately, that's what you want. But then you also want to see that stat of how many times they did get parked, because that's also important. That means that those callers are coming in and they're coming in at a time where people are unavailable. So sometimes you want those, sometimes you don't. But like Dan has said, there's a lot of different ways to be able to filter that out. That C001, Dan, you are spot on, is a great way to be able to filter out those parking lot devices. But within your data, there may be several ways to be able to accomplish that same thing as well.
Flexibility is nice there. Yeah, definitely.
Yep. Excellent. Thanks, gentlemen, for the confirmation. Another really good question from Bobby, and I wanted to address this because we get this question all the time. Bobby wants to know, what is the difference between no air and normal call clearing? So we talked about those terminating cause codes. So really quick, the terminating cause code of no air basically means that the person who initiated the calling party is who hung the call up. That's who's responsible for hanging the call up. If we see the opposite of normal call clearing, that indicates that the recipient of the call or the terminated party actually hung the call up first. So the distinction between those two are very important, especially if you're trying to find out true abandonment rates, right? We want to know which side of the call hung up. It's not always best customer service practices to have an inside agent actually doing the hanging up. We want to allow for the outside party to do the hanging up. So that's what those cause codes stand for. I think we have a duplicate question here. I just want to address it though. Manuel asks for CCX wallboards. Will we be working with single sign-on? Mentioned yesterday, we are in current development with Okta to get the Finesse API to function with single sign-on. So that is a work in progress, but we are actively working on that now. So hopefully that answers your question, Manuel. Let me just jump through here and see if we've got any other questions that we could address here. I think for the most part, we've addressed all the questions that came in this afternoon. Like we said before, we'll be certainly reaching out to all the winners announced today and yesterday. I did also want to mention for everyone that has registered and has attended, please head to webpage cdrkittens.com, submit your information. We'll be giving out our annual t-shirts. So we still wanna do that for you guys. So again, that's cdrkittens.com, fill in the quick form and we'll be shipping out some t-shirts to y'all. So if there's no other questions at this time, Phil, if you're still on, I'll hand it back over to you to wrap it up for today.
Yeah, thanks, Dan. Again, thank you all for attending today and yesterday. I think this was a really successful inaugural block party for Variphy. I don't know, should we do it again next year? I'm thinking so.
Yeah, buddy.
Yes, let's do it.
Yeah, a huge shout out to everybody that made this happen. Dre, Danny, Lane, Annie, Tom, Mike, Matt, Dan, a lot of other folks behind the scenes as well. I'm probably forgetting names, but yeah, so it was a huge effort and I just want to give a huge shout out to everybody. Again, everybody online, thanks a lot. If we didn't get your question answered, please reach out offline. Want to wish you a safe and a very wonderful rest of your day. So signing off until next year. I'm sure we'll be talking to you in between. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Hi, everyone.
Okay.